We're down in the labs in our research center, CRU, the Center for Conservation and Research of Endangered Wildlife. I'm with Dr. Terry Roth, who runs the program, and she's the world's expert on the reproductive biology of Sumatran rhinos. And I know there's news now. I've read some articles, or at least the synopsis. I didn't really understand them, but I guess they run the genome of the Sumatran rhino and discovered things?
That's right, yeah. We've been a part of this program, and this has been a research project that's been international in scope. And our colleagues have actually gotten together and sequenced the genome of the Sumatran rhinoceros using tissues from our former rhino, Ipuh, who lived right here in Cincinnati and was incredibly successful in producing three offspring here at the Cincinnati Zoo. So this project has been very, very interesting in giving us some insight to the evolutionary history and ecological niche of this species over time. And it's amazing what information you can get from a single animal's genome. And I think it's even been shocking to me. Genetics, of course, is not my expertise, but I find it fascinating that what we have learned by looking at the genome of Ipuh and how this species has been in decline for a very, very long time.
Okay, so we think of it as one of the rarest animals in the world today, but how long ago were their numbers low?
Yeah, you know, I always thought this species had really crashed fairly recently, that the population was much more robust, and then in recent times it had really gone down. That's not the case. They have actually been in decline for about 1 million years.
Wow.
Yeah, and the numbers were as low as potentially 700 rhinos 9,000 years ago. So that tells us incredible bottleneck for this species, a lot of inbreeding over the years, and it really helps explain maybe some of the problems that we've seen with them and some of the challenges that they've faced. But what a fighter.
Oh, man alive. I mean, really. So is it at 700 animals, but it must have gone up from there, because I've read records of them, say, a century or two ago being throughout the forest from, you know, western India all the way to Malaysia.
Yeah, well, throughout the Pleistocene, I think it was a real roller coaster for this species, and it depended on what the climate change was doing. So when things warmed up and the sea level rose, then they had less access to the land, but when it cooled and the sea dropped, then they had more access and could spread out, and the numbers could increase a little bit. But it is interesting that the numbers were never high. I mean, we think the maximum was maybe 57 to 60,000 total in the world. So it was never a really populated species.
So simply put, because I'm a simple thinker on this, it sounds like by running the genome, evolution leaves markers so they can tell somehow that, like you said, almost 1 million years ago, here were some information. Right?
Yeah, and it's really the way they're looking at it is, you know, we all inherit chromosomes from our mother and from our father, and so there are two alleles for each gene. And the geneticists have done enough calculations and looked at done enough research to know there's a certain amount of variation that you can expect if the species is breeding with a lot of different individuals. And so what they start to look is how many of those alleles are homozygous. And based on that information, they can determine how much inbreeding has been going on.
Oh, okay.
And that's an indication of how small the population is.
That's amazing. And of course, today it's probably its all-time smallest. I know you go over every year. You've recently gone over to Sumatra to work with the animals, including two of ours that now live there. What do scientists think the numbers look like now?
Currently, folks are estimating that there could be as low as 30 Sumatran rhinos left in the wild.
Wow.
Hopefully, it's more like 100. That number is also thrown around. Either way, it's extremely low. And these populations are very fragmented. And so there's quite an effort underway right now to encourage the Indonesian government to move some of these small populations of rhinos to either larger populations of wild rhinos or to the managed breeding program. And I think for our two male rhinos that are currently in Sumatra at the Sumatran Rhino Sanctuary, it's good news because they should be getting more mates in the near future.
Yeah. It's a remarkable program, but a lot of times you'll read that there's no hope, but I know you work hard on it. Our zoo's been involved since 1989, 1990, and hopefully through the work of the Indonesians, the work of international effort of scientists and conservationists, they can be saved.
Yeah, you know, I've always believed in a multi-prong approach. You know, we're not going to save them by one specific method, but if we try to do a number of different things, there's a good chance we can still save them. And I think it's remarkable the contribution the Cincinnati Zoo and Botanical Garden has made, because we have conservationists now who used to criticize the managed breeding program who are now saying it's the only way we're going to save them. Thank goodness we learned how to breed that species in a managed program.
Absolutely, and that happened here at the Cincinnati Zoo and at our CRU Center. and thanks to the leadership of Dr. Terry Roth, hope still is out there for the Sumatran rhino.